It is for me very important to have a regular dialogue with you, regional and local leaders. This dialogue, I think, is even more important today that Europe is going through one of the most difficult crises of its history. And I believe that is our collective duty and responsibility to continuously argue that Europe remains the only credible response to the crisis we are facing, like the refugee crisis and the building of walls, the emergence of the anti-democratic voices, the rise of unemployment and poverty, or the weakening of solidarity. In this difficult context, your role, I think, is crucial. In your position, you are the closest to our citizens to explain not only the challenges Europe is facing, but mostly that only a more united Europe will be able to provide the right solutions to those challenges. Cohesion policy is certainly part of these solutions. It is the only EU policy whose functioning is based on a real partnership with the member states and with the regional and local authorities. Today, I would like to share with you a few thoughts. First, on the contribution of cohesion policy to growth and jobs, and secondly, on my priorities for this new year, which a particular focus on the post-2020 cohesion policy. For the very first time, we are not only able to say in advance how much money we are going to invest, but also, and most importantly, we are what we concretely expect to achieve with this money. This is why the so-called Article 16 report is so important. Today, we are able to say that with our funds, we will support for the next 7 years more than 2 million enterprises and provide over 14 million additional households with access to high-speed broadband. Moreover, 17 million people will benefit from improved wastewater treatment, and over 12 million people will get improved access to drinking water. And the funds will help 10 million unemployed people to improve their chance of finding a job. And more than 40 million people will benefit from improved health services. Dear colleagues, these few examples are impressive. They demonstrate how cohesion policy can change the life of our citizens. They also show our efforts that we made together to improve the transparency and accountability of the largest investment policy of the European Union. But our work, of course, does not stop here. We need to show that we are able to deliver concrete results that are not just wishful thinking, but the benchmark against which we'll evaluate the effectiveness of our policy. Again, your role is crucial. And I strongly encourage you to use your authority and your political leadership to keep the pressure on regions and cities to deliver on those objectives. 2016 will be devoted to implementation of our policy, to translating our European ambitions objectives into high-quality projects at national level. Here, member states, together with the regional and local authorities, have an essential role to play. This year is crucial also in the context of the debate that is starting on the future of the EU budget and of cohesion policy in particular. I believe that the best preparation for tomorrow is doing our best today. This brings me to my second reflection. The discussion on the future of cohesion policy will not be an easy one. You know very well all the debates. Some voices consider that this policy is unable to respond to EU priorities. Others argue that it does not provide a clear value added. Some suggest that the policy should only serve the implementation of structural reforms. While I do not share these opinions, I do believe we should take these concerns seriously and explain better our policy and the positive impact it has had until now in our lives and in our daily lives. I know the Committee of the Regions has started its reflection on the future of cohesion policy, and I very much welcome this. In my view, when talking about the future, these are four questions we really need to address. First, we need to find a fair balance between the need for stable investment in the medium term and the imperative of responding to new priorities or unexpected crises. The refugee crisis has shown that the governance of the policy is not made to provide swift answers. And the member states are not always open to use this policy to tackle such a crisis situation. As you know, the European Commission was very active in this regard, coming up with concrete solutions. But for this to be successfully implemented, the political will and the commitment of the member states involved are essential. Second, we need to prove that the alignment with EU priorities is making our investments more effective, in particular when it comes to structural reforms. Cohesion policy cannot operate in isolation from the wider economic governance of the Union. I know how this link has created concerns among regional and local authorities, including in the Committee of the Regions. But I'm convinced that we cannot and should not shy away from this debate. Third, we need to put simplification at the core of our reflections, not the least by building on the works of the high-level group on simplification for beneficiaries. It is not a matter of making marginal adjustments to a system that has largely remained the same for 20 years. We need a more fundamental reflection on the functioning of this policy. We need a more reform policy. For example, you need clear answers to questions like, are there other delivery mechanisms which ensure a better balance between performance and regularity of expenditure? Do we need more differentiation and proportionality? And finally, we need to reflect on performance. I am convinced that cohesion policy is the only EU policy that made a serious effort to respond to question of performance. As I said at the beginning, we can now say what we invest in the cohesion funding, and we should remind this over and over. But we should not believe that the discussion is over. Far from it, it should continue reflecting on how to make the system even more oriented towards results, performance, and of course, accountability. I believe that your work will be crucial in the next few months to demonstrate that the regional and local actors are ready to engage in this debate with an open mind. I think that the worst service we can do to this policy is to defend the statu quo. We need a clear vision of what we want this policy to deliver after 2020. We need to be leading this debate by raising the right questions and identifying the best answers in a very innovative way. These were, ladies and gentlemen, the main aspects I wanted to share with you today. We are in the beginning of the year. We are in the beginning of the programming period. I think it's the right moment to start a debate on what we would like to have from this policy from now on. Challenges ahead this year are, as you all know, highly demanding, also your work program, and I am very grateful to President Markula that we are engaging already in providing responses, in working together to have a roadmap and to see how we can work together. I strongly believe, as I said, that our fruitful cooperation will be again an invaluable asset for our success in the future. Thank you very much, and of course I am looking forward to hear your vision. Thank you once again.